Hello and welcome to Maastricht University for the first Jean Monnet lecture of this academic year. Tonight we are joined by Commissioner Sinkevicius, who is also a Maastricht alum. My name is Aron Bosman. I'm a master's student of European Law and European Studies here at Maastricht University. And Commissioner, when you graduated here in 2013, you also graduated with an MA in European Studies. So how is it to be back here in Maastricht, and how do you look back at your time studying here?
Well, it's absolutely wonderful. I mean, to go with my family, as we live now in Brussels, of course, we came to Maastricht around a year ago, but that year ago, it wasn't so sentimental. Now, when I entered and looked around the university, I said to Giselle and my wife that, oh, now I see Maastricht as I saw it as a student. So of course, it's very emotional, and it's great to be back at the faculty, seeing students back as well, because I know it was a tough year.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, for you personally, quite a lot has changed since you graduated here. In 2016, you became a member of the Lithuanian parliament, and in 2017, you went on to become a minister in the Lithuanian government. And then in 2019, you were nominated to be a European commissioner. In your hearing before the European parliament, you stated that one of your guiding principles would be to ensure that the policies under your portfolio would contribute to a fairer society, and that you would make sure, or try to make sure, that they would leave no one behind. So how do you feel that in the past 2 years as commissioner, your policies have contributed to this?
First, probably an emblematic, the most emblematic initiative of this commission is the European Green Deal. And it's not an easy transition when we speak about climate neutrality. I think some people tend to simplify things and simplify the scope of the transition that we will have as a society to undertake. And one important thing to always bear in mind is how to make this transition fair and equal to all, and ensure that those that are actually are in a very unfavorable social conditions, that they wouldn't be left even further away, and those that already advanced wouldn't go further. And I think with all our policies, I'm very proud that we always base it on very solid socioeconomic impact assessment is one, but secondly, we always try to accompany with the funding based on the principle on member states, on the level that they are in the transition, that the help they need, of course, leaving enough leverage for member states as well to adopt. And I think that's an important step which shows that, you know, we want to be ambitious in our climate policies, but we want to make sure that the Green Deal is actually accepted by citizens. Because in the end of the day, it's going to be impossible to implement the Green Deal without the citizens' willingness to do, without the farmer, without the fisherman or women, without a forester or a coal miner in Poland.
Well, it's interesting that you mentioned like the support by citizens, because over the past years we have seen many young people take to the streets to demand climate action. Yet at the same time, we also see that young people are often in vulnerable positions, economically speaking. Many member states have high levels of youth unemployment. Tonight, your Jean Monnet lecture will be about the economic logic behind the Green Deal. So could you elaborate on how the European Green Deal will affect the economic position of young people?
First of all, I think we have to see Green Deal as an opportunity. I always say, and this morning, for example, I was talking to a business society. I said that in the end of the day, if you look, we have different positions as regards when to achieve, climate neutrality with China or Brazil. So some of them pick 2060 goal, some of them take 2050, but then the spread of how to achieve it goes later on. But most importantly, all that transition will require a lot of technologies that will create a lot of new opportunities. And someone will be very fast and will use the first mover's advantage and will be selling those technologies. And someone will be last on that transition buying those technologies to achieve what I think everyone agrees that we have to achieve. As I said, you know, we only have now major debate 2060 or 2050, how to make that transition fair and even how to have society on board. So I think it gives enormous opportunities, especially to young people, because this transition will be accompanied with big data, with blockchain, with digital technologies, which I think young people, you know, they already have it sort of in their blood from the very beginning. You don't have to go over, you know, explanation. My son, who is 5 years old, he is already playing games which are actually based on how to work with data, how to code and so on, which, you know, I couldn't imagine myself being 5 years old doing such things. So I think it will offer tremendous opportunities to young people. But of course, young people also will have an enormous challenge. The world is changing and moving very fast. The scope of information that we are receiving, I think, you know, is enormously big, and you will have to find in all that, you know, the relevant information which you can use and apply, not to lose the social skills, because they still are going to play an important role. So that's going to be always a challenging world, but I think the world which offers a exciting opportunities.
Well, it's interesting that you mentioned the world and also Brazil and Australia. What we see now, currently COP26 is going on, and we hear that new pledges are made towards net zero in 2050, 2060. The European Union has very ambitious targets. We now have a president in the White House who also has ambitious targets when it comes to climate. Yet at the same time, there are countries in Asia, China, India that you mentioned, that have not accepted such ambitious targets. So how does the European Green Deal or how does European policy help to ensure that we also achieve these climate goals in other parts of the world, especially if the European Union is only accountable for 8% of global CO2 emissions?
On one hand, you're right, we are accountable for 8%. But we also cannot hide behind those 8% because, you know, we had our CO2 emissions released when we created all this magnificent infrastructure which we all using and enjoying and so on. And some countries still need to do that, and we have to help them in that transition. But I think what's most important, we have to lead by example. I think we have the privilege, we have a concrete plan. Now in COP26, we are the ones that we can speak with credibility. Nobody has such a detailed plan as our Fit for 55 package, which has a concrete steps how to achieve minus 55% goal by 2030. And I think only by leading by example, we can credibly speak with countries who are less ambitious. And we can speak about, you know, the challenges that they have to overcome, that the investments that they need, and of course investments that we might provide, depending on, of course, reforms that they are willing to implement. So, you know, when we started the European Green Deal, we were sort of starting that zero emissions club. And today, as you've mentioned, we not only are the only ones at the table, but we have even more ambitious ones. UK, for example, goal is way ambitious as ours. Scandinavian countries within the EU is more ambitious than 2050. And then we have United States with a completely different approach with the goal of 53% by 2030, which is just 2% difference from us. Then we have Korea, Australia also already joined with the 2050 club, Japan, and New Zealand. So the club is expanding, and I think more and more countries are joining. I truly hope that with the technological progress, we're going to have a change rhetorics in those other countries as well. Because in the end of the day, climate change is not only environmental policy. It's about your citizens' health. It's about your economy health. And in the end of the day, is this planet is going to be inhabitable to us humans. And I think clearly we see the changed rhetorics of those leaders who were actually 2-3 years ago making jokes that maybe 2 or 3 degrees additional in their countries will just make a positive difference. Now those jokes are gone. Everyone is serious and looking for a plan.
Since you graduated here in 2013, you became the youngest commissioner in 2019. Would you have some advice to the current students of Maastricht University, to the current students of European Studies?
Enjoy your time in Maastricht, first of all, because it's a very short time. If it's only 1 year as for me, so it's an extremely short time. So take as much as you can. I think, you know, this faculty, this university has a special aura, which really you can bond with and take a lot of, you know. Enjoy your time. It's a great institution, which not only allows you to develop, but also it gives you all the required skills to achieve any of career goals. I don't know if you want to be a commissioner, a CEO, or a just an active citizen.
We can't all be commissioners.
Up to you.
Thank you very much, Jer. I'm looking forward to hearing your lecture.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thanks.